of sinners, walk out of this place. This journey is not for you. Because this journey is where Jesus meets the sinners. Jesus heals sinners. So that is what we are here for. To have a deeper relationship with Lord Jesus and to be healed of our sins. That is why this journey is important. It's like any other thing. When you make a cake, you don't just make a cake. You prepare, you get all the ingredients, you put them in proportions, measure to do that, and the temperature control, so many things just to do the cake. How more important are you to come into the kingdom of God? How much we should prepare ourselves? That is why this journey is step-by-step process which has brought us to this point. Now, why community? I told you, if I didn't come to the community of Good Shepherd prayer group, my growth would have been stunted. I will continue to read the Bible, I will continue to pray, I will continue to go to the Mass, I will do all the things personally I have to do, but I would never have the opportunity to have received what I have received now in the growth of the community. First thing, think about it. Each one of you received the gift of the Holy Spirit. And they were not same. They were different gifts. Now, you are going to a group of people, 12 people, with 12 different gifts to give and share. How powerful is that? Could there be any problem that of yours that cannot be resolved without any one of those gifts? There are 12 gifts to work for you. Why would you miss it? Why would anyone miss it? So that's the number one reason. The amount of gifts in that group has multiplied. Everyone has a gift, special gift to share and give. So that is one of the most important reasons that we become a part of a community. And there are other reasons. And if you are in a community, you can share things easily because you learn to trust one another. It's like another second family you belong to. You can open your heart. There are things you can't talk to your parents or your son, children or husband or wife. Always happens. We are all humans. There are things we struggle to share. But you can always find a person in the community group where you can open your heart and share and ask for a prayer. And God knows, there may be people with the same issue in that group needing the same help. So while you are being helped, unbeknown to you, there is someone else helped as well. They wouldn't have asked or mentioned. So you are doing a two-in-one in that time. And that is where you speak and listen to Jesus firsthand. Why? He promised, if ever there is two or three persons gathered in my name, I will be there. I will be there. He did not say, I may be there. I should be there, but I won't have time to come. But he said, I will be there. That means every time he will be there. And he said to Thomas, you believed in me because you saw me. But blessed are those who believe yet who have not seen me. If you believe in your heart that Jesus is present, he is there. What else do we need? He is there for us to talk to and listen to. He will speak to us. Every prayer meeting we have, he speaks to somebody. He gives a word. He gives a message. And that is shared with the whole group. And he, every time, every week it happens. Isn't that great? Talking to Jesus? And also being in a community offers your shoulders to cry. You can unload your pain. If you ever feel that you are lonely, no one to help you, no one to listen to you, don't struggle by yourself. You have shoulders. You can cry, you can unload your pain. And then in that process, you will be unloading your weight to Jesus. And that's what he said. Bring that to me. I will make your load light. So that is where it happens. And when the next thing that we do in a community, we intercede for the community members, also for others who are not community members. That intercessory prayer is a very powerful prayer because many people with one vision talking to Jesus about a request. And I'm not boasting, so many miracles have happened, including curing of cancers, and so many things have happened because of the intercessory prayers in our group, in the Good Shepherd group. So I'm not talking this, I'm not uplifting Good Shepherd group only, any community, but I can only talk about Good Shepherd group. I'm part of the Good Shepherd group, so I can talk about that. And so in short, the community creates a new family in spirit to share, help, grow, love, and celebrate. We do celebrate. We are joyful when we pray for somebody and something happened and they had a breakthrough. I mean, that happiness is worth thousands of dollars. God's grace on someone to heal them is more worth than anything that you can buy. But that's only the first part of the community living that I'm talking about. The second part, we also have the need, or not the need, actually, we also have been asked to go out and share the good news. Paul VI said one of the most important criteria for a Christian is to evangelize. So, evangelizing creates communities. You don't know which community you'll be creating, but you will be creating a community. Now, how do we do this? We are not trained. Don't worry. We have the best teacher in the world. Not only he has given us the syllabus, he has given us the curriculum, he has given us tutorial and living examples. Can you guess who it is?
Jesus.
Absolutely. Lord Jesus. There's nothing that he has left unknown. He said, you are not slaves, you are not servants, you are my friends. I have shared everything I know with you. So, Jesus has given us all the information. We have to just look up. There's nothing challenging once we understand the love Jesus had for us and how he helped us. Francis of Assisi said, go and evangelize, but speak if you really need to speak. So evangelization is not delivering a speech like this, or to a man. dance, audience getting up on the stage and talking, they are good things, not bad. But that's not the only way to evangelize. The best evangelization comes from leading by example. You lead your life in a way that touches the heart of someone else. That removes the fear in their heart to come to God. That makes them comfortable to understand God's word. It makes them happy to listen to God's word. It makes them lovable and it makes them love others because what they see in you. They should wonder, what does he has or she has that I don't have? She's always happy, she's always joyful. Nothing shakes and I see smiling face all the time. What is he drinking? Drinking Jesus' blood every day, eating his body every day. And that love, that difference should be seen by the other people. You are his disciples. Jesus said, you obey my command, then others will know that you are my disciples. Love Father and love others like I have loved you. Then others will know that you are my disciple. Simple. It's not complicated. The steps that we have to do that we have done. Forgive, repent, reconcile. We have done that. And we can do that again because we are weak and our flesh is weak. Even St. Paul says, my mind says this, but I'm doing the things my mind doesn't say. St. Paul, the great, even he has confessed, I'm doing the things I don't want to do instead of the things I should be doing. So, we are not greater. But God loves sinners. Paul finished his race. He fell. He stumbled. But he never took the focus of Jesus. He always was there. Similarly, if you do not take the focus of Jesus, this is easy for us. And we should not underestimate the power we have as a single person. There are 2.18 billion Christians in this world now. Started from 12 in 2020 years, 2.18 billion. That's the great growth rate of 120,000 per month. If you work out your maths, I did that. So, 12 people. So, power of one. Each one of you can save thousands of people. It's an exponential growth. You don't go in 2,000. You save only one, and that person saves another one. And those people save another one. So you keep on. So it's like two to the power six. It grows so fast. But you consistently keep on doing that. Look for opportunity God throws in your path. Don't have a blind eye and walk away. Listen to the sufferings of the people Lord brings in your path. God will not give you challenges you can't handle. His strength and power is always with you. So, he will guide you. You need to ask. You need to have the heart to do that. You should be ready. Lord, I'm ready now. Tell me what to do. Show me the way. Show me the path. Ask. He will give if that is his will. And same thing. I mean, if you go to St. Peter, he did the same thing. He started off one person, single. God said, go to the Gentiles. And these are people who have not heard about Jesus. And how many thousands at the end of the day came out with one man, St. Paul? How many communities he has created? And how many communities 100% sure of what he was doing. He knew who Jesus was, and he never doubted that. And he argued so much, come away from the law. He was abiding law for many years. That was his gospel. He come from that background. Law was everything. He preached against the law. If you are obeying law, you have no part in Jesus' love. Law will be automatically obeyed when you love Jesus and when you have faith in him. And you do the things because it's the right thing to do in the kingdom of God. So that is why he was so strong. He never went away from that. Are we strong? Maybe not. But can we be strong? Absolutely yes. Or each one of us have that gift. God will give us. And I want to just finish with a couple of quotes from the Bible. This is reassurance that Jesus is with us. Who are we? We are Gentiles. We are not part of the Jewish community. Anything not part of the Jewish community is Gentiles. So Jesus prayed for us. In John chapter 17, Jesus says, my prayer is not for them. Before this, he prayed for his people, chosen people. If you read John 17, you will read that before. This starts from verse 17, verse 20 to 23. So before that, he prayed for the people. And then he says, my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. That passage, you can meditate on that for a day. It's so powerful. If you really delve into that, go deeper and deeper, you've got how many promises Jesus has thrown us there and how much he has asked for us from his Father. We don't need anything. He has already asked his Father to be with us. And he said his Father never refuses him. So that means we have that guarantee. Jesus has given the guarantee to us that Father is blessing us. And then the one before the last is I want to take through Galatians about the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, and how we've got to be careful because we are humans. This is Galatians chapter 5, verse 13, then 16, then 19 to 23. Verse 13, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. And for us, it has happened. We have been freed when we receive the Holy Spirit. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. And this he stresses again and again. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. So this is what I have been talking about all this time about community. Humbly love one another. And 16, he repeats again, so I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. And then he goes to define, now, how do we know that we are walking in the Spirit, and we are not walking The acts of the flesh is this, acts of the spirit is this. So you need to ask the question, are you indulging in flesh or are you indulging in spirit? If the answer is indulging in flesh, then ask the question, how do I get out of that and come to indulging or come to living in spirit? And tools for that we have given these 7 weeks, how to come from there to here. So acts of the flesh now, this is the list he has given. Acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissension, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies and the like. That's a long list. So ask the question, if something happening in your life and you're not happy, ask the question, what is any of these is in my life? If you are not happy, I will guarantee 100% one of them is there in your life. 100%, without any doubt. Because if it is not there, you will never be sad. You will be happy. That is the next part. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. This is a simple test. Every time you are miserable, every time you are unsure, every time you have fear in your heart or something, every time you are uncomfortable, go to this list, Galatians, and ask, is any of them could be causing that? Then pray to Jesus. Tell him openly, Lord, I have recognized this is taking me away from you. Can you help me to come back to you? Go and do your reconciliation. Repent for what you have done. Forgive the person who has done something to you. If you have been provoked, some people get provoked all the time because we have all weak spots in ourselves, and the third person can provoke us easily, and that leads to anger. So do a self-examination for your sadness. There will be an answer. So I'm going to finish with the last one. The important thing is prayer. Pray, pray, pray. I can't stress. I don't know whether you know what stands for pray, P-R-A-Y. Start your prayer, P, with praise. In the Old Testament, we know King Jehoshaphat, because he was asked to go to this war. And this enemy is very powerful and he's got this great army and he was so scared. And he didn't know what to do. He was so scared he started praising the Lord, singing praise songs. And the next day, in the enemy camp, there was so much confusion. They fought among themselves without knowing who they are fighting, and they ran away. And there was no fight. So he won without fighting. So that is what praise does. I repent. I know you all know David, King David. He fell big time. He made a mess and made a big mess by killing Uriah's husband. And then Prophet Nathan came to him and gave him the light. Why did you steal that one lamp that belongs to that poor man when you had 100 lamps? And he did not understand what was he talking about. And when he understood, he felt so sorry. And he repented. And God forgave him. Repent. Ask. P-R-A-Y. Ask. If you remember in the Old Testament, Hannah, mother of Samuel, she was ridiculed for being barren. and she didn't have any kids. So she prayed, and she prayed to God saying, "You give me a son, and I will give my son back to you." What a beautiful prayer. You give me a son, and I will give him back to you. So we are not praying just, she didn't say, "I need a son, my ego is hurt, I need to prove to my other, his other wife that I am capable of producing the children, and I will make him grow into a bigger person, better person now." She was humble. That is asking humbly, saying, "Give me, I'll give it back to you." So your prayers, ask, when you ask, be careful what you ask. Don't ask for material things. Always have love in heart for you and others. Then what you ask will be proper, and God will love that. And always it ends with God's will. Even Jesus asked in Gethsemane, he said, "I don't want to die like this, Lord. This is horrible. Can you change this plan?" And then he said, "It's not my will, but it's your will." So we need to understand that every time we pray, there's no guarantee to be given. But what will be given will definitely be for your good. Because sometimes we ask not knowing what will be given is good or bad. We ask for everything. And the last one is yield. Why? Yield is kind of listen, surrender to God. Like Samuel, God called him 3 times and he didn't know. He got up and went to Elisha. Then finally he said, "No, just listen." And when he says, "Say, Lord, here I am." And that's what he did. "Lord, here I am. Servant, tell me what to do." So that is why yielding, listening. And this is what we do in our community prayer group as well. We start with praise and worship, you would have seen every day. And then we go into this more of self-analyzing and offering ourselves and our force to the Lord.